Hello everyone, today we will be solving Jan 21 Physics Unit 6. Okay, so here we have a ball oscillating between two points. Okay, so this is a surface and this is another surface, and the ball is oscillating between these points, between these surfaces. We have to describe how we can measure the time period of the oscillation as accurately as possible. So this is a very common question. For any oscillatory type of experiment, it is better for us to measure multiple oscillations. I like to take 10 oscillations as a standard. You measure the time taken for 10 oscillations and then divide the time taken by 10. So then you will get the time for one oscillation. And you repeat this thing multiple times and then take the average time. And to mark when your oscillation starts, you can have a marker over here, something like a marker over here. And then when the ball passes through this point, you start your timer, and when the ball passes again, you stop your timer. So a marker can be very useful. Then the next question is, if you can see, describe how a single measure of d could be made accurately. Okay, so how to measure the distance d as accurately as possible? So this distance is quite large, so we have to use a meter rule. That's number one. Number two is we have to make sure that the meter rule is horizontal, so we have to use a spirit level. Okay, and number the third point is the third important point. Well, the first point wasn't the meter rule. The first point was the meter rule and the spirit level together. Now the second point is that we have to see the reading from directly above the markings so as to avoid parallax error. Okay, so here we have some data points for T and D, and the student predicts that the T is directly proportional to the root of D. If that is so, then T will be equal to K of root over D, right? In that case, T by D will always be giving a constant value, a value of K. So let us divide the different values of T and root D and see if we get a constant value. So by dividing the different values, okay, so 0.78 divided by root over of 2.235, 0.94 divided by root 0.335, 1.09 divided by root over of 0.445, we get very similar values. And since the values are very similar, therefore, yes, our results are consistent with the prediction. You have to write this line separately. I haven't written it here, but you have to write that line. Okay. So we want to measure the current through capacitors and the time taken for the current to fall. So what circuit we can use? So this is a very standard circuit that we can use. Take note. This is a battery. These are your capacitors, and this is your ammeter, and this is your resistor. And that's your switch, of course. This is your switch. Okay. One safety precaution. Yes, of course, the capacitors have voltage limits, and we should not cross that limit or else we can damage the capacitor. So now how we can do the experiment in detail and how to measure and how to get the value for the total capacitance of the capacitors. Okay, so we measure the resistances of various resistors. Remember, we have to use a resistor for our experiment, right? So we have to measure the resistances of many resistors, and then we select a suitable resistor, something that will not charge the capacitor to a very high level. Okay, after that we will charge the capacitors to the initial value. We'll charge them fully, and then we'll start discharging them. We'll start the stopwatch discharging, and at regular time intervals we will start taking the values of time and the current. Okay, so we have values of time and we have the values of current. So you can assume what equation we will use. We will use the equation I is equal to I naught e to the power minus 1 by RC into t. So this is the equation that we are going to use. So here t is time, this t here is time, this I naught is the initial current, this I is the current after the time t. So we measure multiple readings of time and current, then we process the data to get ln i and t, and then we plot ln i versus t. If you plot ln i versus t, what happens is you see here you see ln I is equal to minus 1 by RC t plus ln I naught. So we have plotted this ln in the y-axis, the t in the x-axis. So that is your y, that is your x. So this 1 by RC minus 1 by RC that you get, that is your gradient. And ln I naught is your, I've written it n, ln I naught is your constant or the y-intercept. So that is not important here for this question at least. So from the gradient, we get 1 by RC, and we know the value of the resistance, right? We measured it in the first line itself. So from there, we know the value of resistance, we can get the capacitance. Okay. So this entire thing could be done by using a data logger, an electronic method, and that is better, as you can understand. So you have to take the reading of time as well as the reading of the current, right? So you can understand that these values are continuously changing. So by the time that you read, take a reading, write it down, and then come back to your experiment again, there can be human errors, of course. So in these sort of experiments, it is better to have electronic systems of taking data. Advantage being simultaneous readings of I and T being taken, there will be no delay, so it will be more accurate, and we can take more number of readings in a very short time. Okay, so here we have a separate experiment. Please take a moment to read the question. And we're being asked that whether the y graph of log r against log a can be used to determine a value of n. So see, this is the mother equation, and if you take log on both sides, we get this equation. Log r is equal to n log a plus log. So we want to plot log r on the y-axis, log a on the x-axis. If that is so, the gradient will give us the value of n. So that is our 2 marks. Now we have to plot the graph itself. I have processed the data over here. So we have to plot log r against log a, right? We have a and we have r. This fm means femtometer. So we have to make a data chart of log a and log r, since we have to plot log a and log r. After that, I haven't plotted the graph exactly. I've just shown the shape. This is the general shape of the graph, okay? So you will have the graph entirely above the x-axis. This is your zero mark, and you will have some sort of graph like this. From there, you have to calculate the value of n. We had established earlier that the value of n will be given by the value of the gradient. So you measure the value of the gradient, okay? How to measure the value, how to calculate the value of the gradient? You take a very big triangle, as big as possible, and then you measure the rise divided by the run. So that will give you the value of your gradient, and that gradient will be exactly equal to your value of n. So luckily n is exactly equal to a gradient, so we don't have to do any processing over here. Your value of n should lie somewhere between 0.3 to 0.34. Okay, the value of r naught. We had seen earlier that the value of log r naught is given by the y-intercept. So we know the y-intercept from our graph. So from a graph, the y-intercept is 0.09. So log r naught is equal to 0.09. From there, we can get the value of r naught. That is 1.23 femtometers. Okay. Please take a moment to read the question. The uncertainty of both the instruments are the same, but the student B takes a bigger measurement, and we are being asked which will have the lesser percentage uncertainty. We know percentage uncertainty is equal to uncertainty divided by the measurement. The uncertainty is same for both because they're using the same tool, but the measurement of student B is bigger. If the measurement is bigger, then automatically you can see, according to the formula, the percentage uncertainty will decrease. Please note, don't write shortcuts like this. I've just written it to save my time. Write percentage uncertainty. Write the uncertainty of both student A and B are equal. Write the whole sentence here. And the measurement of B is bigger, so the percentage uncertainty will be smaller. Write the full sentence like this. Okay, how can we take accurate readings of a very small measurement? Okay, so there are two sorts of error, right? We know systematic error and random error. How to reduce the systematic error? Check for zero error, very common error. And random error, yes. When taking measurements, okay, especially of round things like this, you take the measurement of along this plane first, you get one measurement. Then you take measurement along this plane, you get another measurement. Then again, you take measurement along this plane, you get another measurement. So by taking measurement along all these planes, you are accounting for the differences in the the level in all these planes. So by taking the average, you are getting a pretty accurate representation of what the measurement will look like. So how to write the answer? Random error. We take the readings in different positions, we repeat these readings, and then we take average. Okay, the mean value is given by the addition of all these values divided by the number of values. That gives us 2.10 millimeters. Uncertainty is given by range by 2. Range is what? Range is the maximum value minus the minimum value divided by 2. So that gives us this uncertainty. So we know the value of x, it is given here. We know the value of t, that is given here in our this part. We just input those two values and find the value of the circumference. Okay, the uncertainty. Well, the uncertainty, when two parameters are being added or subtracted, the uncertainties can be added. When two values are multiplied or divided, the percentage uncertainty can be added. Keep this in mind. So here in C, since the values of x and the value of t are added together in added form, here you can see that in added or subtracted form, they're in subtracted form. So we can add their absolute uncertainties. The absolute uncertainty in x is 0.2, so we have added 0.2 centimeters. The absolute uncertainty in t was 0.05 millimeters. We have to convert that to centimeters because 0.2 was in centimeters. So 0.005 centimeters. You add the two uncertainties together, you get the total uncertainty of the circumference. So now we are being asked to calculate the volume. We know the value of C, we know the value of L that is given here, we know the value of 4 pi that's a constant, and we know the value of V1 as well. Input all those values, you easily get the value of the volume. Now the challenge is in determining the uncertainty. The problem here is that you have to determine the uncertainty of this part, this CL by 4 pi, and also V1. Well, the uncertainty of V1 has already been given by the question, but you have to determine the uncertainty in CL by 4, C square L by 4 pi. So, since C square and L are in multiplied form, the percentage uncertainties can be added. So, the percentage uncertainty in C square, the percentage uncertainty in C square is the uncertainty 0.025 that we found in a previous part of the question, divided by the measurement into 2. Why into 2? Because the C is in square form. If it was cube, we would have multiplied 3. Then to get the percentage, we multiply by 100. You get the percentage uncertainty in C square. For the percentage uncertainty in L, the uncertainty divided by the measurement into 100, that gives you the percentage uncertainty in L. Now, the percentage uncertainty of C square L by 4 pi, the 4 pi doesn't have an uncertainty, it's just a constant. You add these two uncertainties together, you get the percentage uncertainty in C square L by 4 pi. Now, we got the percentage uncertainty. How to get the absolute uncertainty? That is just the multiplication of your percentage uncertainty with your measurement. So the value of C square L by 4 pi, the value of C square L by 4 pi is given by 998 if you input the values. So multiplying that by your percentage uncertainty, you get the absolute uncertainty. Now, you got the uncertainty of C square L by 4 pi, and you also know the uncertainty of V1. Since they are in minus form, in added or subtracted form, the absolute uncertainties can be added. Or subtract can be added, of course, can be added. So the absolute uncertainty in C square by 4 pi is 19. The absolute uncertainty in V1 is 5 centimeter cube. So we can add those two together and we can get the absolute uncertainty of V as 24 centimeter cube. The value of V was found in the first line over here. So this is also a very common question. We have to determine whether our material is made of soda glass, borosilicate, or perspex. So we have the mass that is given by this, and here is the uncertainty of the mass. So let us determine the density. The density is mass by volume. The mass is given here. The density, the volume we had found in a previous part of the question. Divide those two, you get the density. The percentage uncertainty. Well, here the mass and volume are in divided form. Therefore, the percentage uncertainties can be added. The percentage uncertainties, not the absolute uncertainties. So the percentage uncertainty in mass is given by the uncertainty divided by the measurement into 100, the uncertainty in 1 gram divided by the measurement 463 into 100. The percentage uncertainty in volume, the uncertainty 24 that we found in a previous part of the question, divided by the volume itself, that is 188 into 100. So you got the percentage uncertainty in N and in U. You add them together and you get the total percentage uncertainty in the value of your density. So your density value can vary 13.5% among these values. So how to actually determine your upper and lower limit? Well, you add your 13% of your density to your density, you get the upper value, upper limit. You subtract that limit from your density, you get the lower end of your lower limit of your density. So your correct value for the density that you have measured of this material, your material will have a density of somewhere between 2.14 to 2.78, accounting for all sort of uncertainties. So let us see which materials satisfy this condition. Soda glass does. Soda glass falls within this range. Borosilicate does, but perspect does not fall within this range. Therefore, our materials can be soda glass or borosilicate. The question was, can we heat it directly by a Bunsen burner? Only borosilicate is safe to heat by a Bunsen burner. But according to our calculation, it could be soda glass as well. But soda glass is not safe to be heated by a Bunsen burner. Therefore, we should not heat this thing by a Bunsen burner. So that is the final conclusion. Thank you very much for watching. Stay with me and comment if you want to solve any other paper.